All right, this lecture covers section 9.1, which outlines the general features of cell communication. Cell communication is really vital, and I think there could be no more obvious statement as I can make than that. When you're a multicellular organism, right, there's a lot of things that need to be able to coordinate, a lot of tissues and organs that need to coordinate their activities. And so it's important that there's an ability to not only adjust as an individual cell, but it's also important to have an ability to signal other cells to adjust and adapt as well. A nice example is apoptosis. Apoptosis is cell suicide, communication of the environment and communication of internal conditions will lead to apoptosis, which often is described as the greater good. If you're a cell that's aberrant, that's not functioning properly, it's best to kill yourself before you divide again and start to repopulate that particular population of cells. Now, it's important to understand that cells are not islands unto themselves. Cells have to have the ability to communicate with the environment and also have the ability to communicate with one another. And so you have incoming signals and outgoing signals. Signals is a general term to represent agents that influence the physiology of the cell, the properties of a cell, structure of a cell. Signals are going to bind to what's called receptors, which is going to start a cascade of events, which ultimately are going to influence those cell properties. So what do cells need to respond to signals? First, they're going to need a response to that signal. So they're going to need to coordinate a response to a changing environment. An example would be the availability of glucose in an environment. We know glucose is used for energy production. So for a yeast, glucose is a signal that it needs to start to produce the enzymes and proteins necessary to utilize that glucose to generate ATP, to store away that glucose via a series of anabolic reactions. It doesn't make sense for a yeast cell to continuously produce proteins that it does not need. So only when glucose is available does it make sense for that yeast cell to start to spend the energy and the resources necessary to import and utilize that substrate. So here's a nice example. Here we have a glucose receptor on the surface of that yeast cell embedded within the cell membrane. It's important to note that because it's a fungi, that yeast do have a cell wall that's pictured there. But we know cell walls are not impermeable, they're permeable. So now when glucose becomes available, those receptors are bound. Notice what type of protein is pictured here for the glucose receptor. That's right, that's an integral membrane protein. It has an extracellular domain and an intracellular domain. So when the extracellular domain is bound to its glucose, a conformational change occurs, transmitting that then change to the inside of the cell, and now that domain of the protein can go on and cause a cellular response. In this case, it's going to respond by initiating the production of glucose transporters, as well as those metabolic enzymes that are critical in storing away that glucose and utilizing it for energy production. Secondly, what do cells need to respond to signals? They need to be able to communicate with one another. Once one cell receives a signal, it has to have the ability to tell others of its state. So cell-to-cell communication is very important. A great example is seen here in the ability of a plant to grow towards light. Light, in this case, is the signal. In phototropism, what occurs is in response to light, the cell changes its structure and elongates on one particular side in order to cause a bend in the stem of this particular blade of grass. And now, as we can see, because the cells have elongated, causing a kink in its structure, the plant is in a better position to absorb that light than it would have been if it grew straight up and or away from that incoming light. And so if you go on YouTube and you type in phototropism, you'll actually see time-lapse photography where they actually show a plant growing in the direction which the light is coming. So that's a nice example of how cells can communicate with one another, coordinate their activities, coordinate their characters in order to adjust and respond to that environmental signal. So now, how are signals relayed between cells? We have direct intercellular signaling. So between cells, we have junctions that allow for the flow of signal molecules directly from one cell to another. We have contact-dependent signaling, where molecules are bound to the surface of the cells, which then recruit other cells to come in contact, hence the term contact-dependent signaling. We have autocrine signaling. Autocrine, auto means self. Cells secrete molecules that bind to their cell surface, causing an additional response, so it's stimulating itself. Also, it's secreting chemicals to stimulate other neighboring cells of the same type. We have paracrine signaling, endocrine signaling to finish it up. Paracrine signaling, the signal does not bind to the cell that secretes it itself, but it does influence those cells around it. Synaptic signaling is a nice example when we have, for example, neurotransmitters being released. Those neurotransmitters don't necessarily stimulate the cell that secreted it, but it certainly stimulates those cells that are connected through, for example, neuromuscular junctions. Finally, hormones are part of endocrine signaling. Hormones can be secreted from one area of the body, travel through the body system, and impact cells that are long distance away. So we have sort of signaling in the immediate area, and then we also have long-reaching signaling in the example of endocrine signaling. And here's just some pictures of what we're talking about. Gap junctions, the molecules never enter the extracellular space. They just travel through junctions to neighboring cells as a way to respond. Here we have the binding of a signal molecule to its receptor, initiating interactions between neighboring cells. That's contact dependent. Here we have the autocrine, in which a signal molecule is secreted, binds to a receptor on the surface of the secreting cell, causing an increased response here in this cell. Also, then the signals bind to other cell receptors and neighboring cells, causing them to respond as well. Here we have the signal secreted by the initial cell not working as an auto signal, but rather working on target cells that are in the vicinity. And lastly here, paracrine signaling. We can see that hormones released from one area can be, for example, carried through the bloodstream and impact a target cell in a whole nother area of a whole different cell type. So there are three stages of cell signaling you're going to learn about in this chapter. First is receptor activation. In receptor activation, we have a signaling molecule which binds to a receptor. We're going to see a receptor can be located on the surface, as was the example in the glucose receptor, or we can have intracellular receptors located in the cytoplasm for those small lipid-based receptors that can diffuse through the phospholipid bilayer. Once that happens and receptor is bound, we have a signal transduction pathway in which we communicate between the receptor and then the targeted pathway. So it's a way for us to transduce the signal. It is similar to if I want to relay a message to someone in the back of the room, rather than shouting it, I could tell the first person in the row, they turn around, tell the second person, tell the third person, until it reaches its final destination. That is similar to what signal transduction does. The third and most important step then is we got to do something about it. We have the signal, we have a change in the environment, we have to respond. So once we get the signal, what are we going to do? We can alter existing proteins. So rather than having to worry about making new enzymes, let's take enzymes that exist and turn them on and or turn them off in response to that signal. We can alter structural proteins. We saw examples in the case of cells elongating. In order to respond to light, we could change structural features of cells. Lastly, and most importantly, we can alter gene expression. We could turn on the production of proteins required to respond. We could turn off the production of proteins required to respond to that signal. And here's a nice summary from your textbook. Inactive receptor protein binds the signal. Notice a conformational change here in the protein, specifically on the intracellular domain facing the cytoplasm. Once active, the cytoplasmic domain here activates a series of proteins, a signal transduction pathway, which ultimately results in the cell response, either by altering existing enzymes, by changing structural proteins, or by traveling to the nucleus in the case of a eukaryotic cell, and altering gene expression, which ultimately is going to impact the quantity and concentration of specific proteins. Now, that's one thing I want to get across before I end this lecture. Specificity is extremely important. It's not one receptor for every possible signal. There's no way a cell could be able to distinguish what's happening in the environment. Those signal molecules have their own receptors, which are going to cause a unique response, which allows a cell to fine-tune and its regulatory steps, allows it to fine-tune its response. And I think that's going to be important as you see examples of the CAMP pathway and the calcium pathway, which you're going to view next.